You are children of the kingdom, and you need to walk like the children of the kingdom. You need to take control like the children of the kingdom. You need to move like the children of the kingdom. For so long, for too long, we allow situations, we allow circumstances to take hold of us. We allow those things in our lives to control and dominate our life. When you should actually be saying, yeah, I'm a child of God. He is in charge. You know?
This is GBC Web TV. On the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspired biblical teaching and find out how to apply God's Word to your everyday lives. On the website you can also listen to audio versions of these programs or download them as podcasts. Today's program is called Let God Take Hold of Your Circumstances, Acts chapter 27 verses 15 to 26 by Rotimi Awoniyi.
Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth. And the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Father God, as we come before the throne this morning to hear you speak to us, to hear you minister to us, we pray, Lord God, that you touch us and you renew us. Those words that we'll be hearing this morning, Father, we pray in the name of Jesus Christ that they'll fall on fertile grounds and they will change us to the people that you want us to be for the kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. There's one thing that I like about GBC, Greenford Baptist Church, is that we allow God to take control in everything that we do. When times are bad, when times are good, we allow him to take control. But that is when we look at ourselves as a family. What of when we are alone in our own world, when we are doing our own things, when we are not among brothers and sisters that are able to lift us up, to work with us? How do we react to situations in our lives? Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. My understanding is the Bible tells me that rejoice and pray and thank him every time, in whatever situation, in whatever circumstance you are. And that's supposed to be our mantras. That's supposed to be what we do on a daily basis, every time, all times. But I know it's difficult. And this morning I'm going to be talking about letting God take hold of our circumstances. Letting God take hold of our circumstances. Most of us know the story of Joseph. How he was sold into slavery. How from being a slave, he became effectively the prime minister of Egypt. How his brothers, looking for food to feed the family, went to Egypt. He recognized them. And eventually the whole family moved there. I'm just going to read a small passage for us here.
Now Joseph and all his brothers and all that generation died. But the Israelites were fruitful and multiplied greatly and became exceedingly numerous, so that the land was filled with them. Then a new king, who did not know about Joseph, came to power in Egypt. Look, he said to his people, the Israelites have become much too numerous for us. Come, we must deal shrewdly with them, and they will become even more numerous. And if war breaks out, we join our enemies, fight against us, and leave the country. So they put slave masters over them to oppress them with forced labor. And they built Pithom and Ramses as store cities for Pharaoh. I don't know where you are this morning. The children of Israel moved into Egypt. And they prospered. And it may be, I want you to cast your mind back to when you first became a believer. When you accepted Lord as your personal savior. You were on fire for God. You believe you could move mountains. You believe anything, everything is possible. Nothing faced you. And think about where you are today, this morning. 17th, today's 17th, isn't it?
Yes.
17th of May, 2009. Map that journey and think about it. You've had the lows and the highs. You've had times that you think, that is it. I can't go on anymore. When situations have been dire and you think, I cannot pray anymore. It may be that is where you are this morning, as the children of Israel found themselves after so many years, possibly so many centuries, and there was a new king that said, look, they are becoming too much for us. Let's put them in bondage. Maybe this morning, you are at a turning point. And I want us to read from Acts 27. Acts 27. From verse 13. Acts 27. Unfortunately, I'm not using the normal church Bible, so I cannot tell you the page. Acts 27 from verse 13. When a gentle south wind began to blow, they thought they had obtained what they wanted. So they weighed anchor and sailed along the shore of Crete. I'll take us back just a little bit. Most of us will remember Paul that persecuted the Christians. How he had the zeal, how he thought that Christians were causing trouble and was all out to see them put down. But God met with him. God met with him very powerfully. And he was preaching. He was speaking about God's goodness. He was speaking about God's grace. He was speaking about God's anointing. He was taking the good news to the Gentiles. And the powers thought, we cannot let this continue. And they took him before the king. And being a Roman citizen, he appealed to the emperor. And so here he was on the ship to Rome for the emperor to hear his appeal. So they had problem on the way. The ship, the wind was troubling them. And then when a gentle south wind began to blow, they thought they had obtained what they wanted. So they weighed an anchor and sailed along the shore of Crete. As I said earlier on, when we map out our journey with God, we've had the good time when everything was going well. Sometimes things are not going well, but you have that space of time, small time, that everything seems to go well. And you thought, yes, this is it. I'm back on the road. And as they journeyed, before very long, a wind of hurricane force called the Northeaster swept down from the island. The ship was caught by the storm and could not head into the wind, so we gave way into it and were driven along. Gave way into it. If anyone came to you and said, when you become a Christian, everything will be smooth sailing all life, I tell you the lie. You will have the good time, and the bad times will be there. And what we are reading here is about, in our life, translated into our life, allowing those circumstances to take hold of us and direct where we go. The Bible says, so they gave way to it and were driven along by it. I don't know where you are this morning. I don't know what situation you are going through this morning. I don't know your circumstance this morning. But are you allowing those things, those circumstances, those things troubling you, are you allowing them to drive you? Are you allowing them to dictate what goes on in your life? Or are you putting everything before the cross and saying, Lord, take control? As we journey through life and things seem to move along nicely, we thought, do we continue to rely on God for sustenance? Sometimes, I've said in the past how when a few years back, those of us that were here at the time will remember, suddenly we found that all I was expecting a baby, nothing to do with me. Yeah. All I was expecting a baby, and we thought, we've got our solution to the problem that we faced. We thought the place we were living was small, 3 bedrooms. Too small to bring four children up. So we thought, the solution. We didn't go to God about it. But we mapped out, as you know, as an accountant, you map out in advance. You think of consequences. Am I right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. You think of consequences. So we thought, we'll find a 4-bedroom house, possibly 5, and we looked around Greenford, too expensive. We went further afield, too expensive, further afield, too expensive, until we found ourselves in Milton Keynes. And there was this beautiful 5-bedroom house on the plan. And I tell you, I fell in love with it instantly. This is good. One for me and for Ola, and one for each of the children. Perfect.
So we went there.
We looked at the plan. It was beautiful. We went to the plot where it was going to be. Nice garden. Very big garden. I thought, that's good. Space in front. So we put the deposit down, and Ola said, before you put deposit down, let me tell you what I want. I want my kitchen to be like this. I want this decor. I want this on the wall. I want that on the wall. I want this to be like this. So whatever you want, darling, anything, just name it. But that was man planning. That was man in his own wisdom saying, this is what I want and this is what I'm going to get. But when you plan and you don't factor God in, there's trouble. So, we paid deposit. I came to the leadership team and I said, right, I've just given you notice that in 2 months' time, I'll be moving out of Greenford. I'm moving to Milton Keynes. And they all looked like me, like I was mad. We put our house on the market. And nobody came to look at it. Those that came said, oh, you have to knock off 5,000, 10,000. And there was one that said, okay, knock 3,000 off. We'll take care. So we said, okay, take care. And then just maybe a week or so, everything was going on smoothly. And he said, actually, everything that you have got, that you've listed as not part of the sale, we want you to include them in the contract. And just before then, Ola bought one beautiful range cooker. And they said, you have to include the range cooker, all the bathroom accessories, you have to leave them, all this, you have to leave those. And Ola said, well, what do you mean? I'm not leaving my cooker behind. I'd rather tear up the contract than leave my cooker behind. We had the mortgage sorted. But at every point, there was problem. At every point, there was problem. At every point, there was problem. Until one day, someone was praying with Ola. And that person said, you are planning to move. And Ola said, yes, we are moving to Milton Keynes. And that person, and before that, someone in the church, I'm not going to name them, said, I'm actually praying, it doesn't go through. And I thought, now I know this person does not like me. So this person was praying with Ola and said, you are planning to move to Milton Keynes? And she said, yes. And that person said, it's not going to happen. Because your church has not released you. Effectively, what that told me was, you did not go to God in prayer. You did not consult with God if that was what God wanted for you. That was your own plan, not God's plan for you. We are still in the house. It's bigger than it was before. It's got 4 bedrooms instead of 3 bedrooms. And I've got my own bedroom, which is good. But what I'm trying to drive at is, when things are going on well, and when we start to plan our own things without God, there is trouble ahead. There is trouble ahead. Life is full of difficulties. Some because of decisions that we have made ourselves. Some through events that are out of our control.
It may be this morning that you are here present, and the situations you are going through is related to health. It may be finance, it may be emotional, whatever it is, sometimes difficulties come in life. Moses felt he had a responsibility to defend the Hebrew that was being brutalized. He intervened and it resulted in the Egyptian being killed. King David, well, before he became king, he certainly didn't do anything to make King Saul want to kill him. But things happen in life. There are difficulties in life. David had done everything that the king wanted of him. That he was anointed by God was not his making. That he was able to do everything perfectly was the way God created him. That he was able to kill Goliath, that was able to lead the army, was because God's strength, God's anointing was upon his head. Saul, later known as Paul, had taken the good news of salvation to Gentiles. He had been accused of various things because he preached the good news. So what I'm saying is life is full of difficulties. Even if you had the whole money in the world, if you are 1 million times richer than Bill Gates, there are still difficulties. There will be. You will have read in the newspapers over the last couple of months, when because of the credit crunch that is affecting all of us, people like the Abramovich, people like Bill Gates, they've seen their wealth sometimes reduced by up to 25%. It's interesting, there was this van company, LDV, I believe, that is owned by a Russian billionaire. And the company that is owned by a billionaire is saying to British government, give us money, otherwise we are going to run into trouble. And the government was saying, the shareholder, the owner of this company is a billionaire. Why can't he put his money in there and to save the company? So every stage in life, but the thing people will not know is these billionaires, they are also suffering. So money does not give us happiness all the time. It doesn't provide everything. And I want to ask this morning, what things can come to destabilize us? Maybe you could help me here. What things can come in life that could destabilize us? What things? Anyone? Illness. You have a small headache one day. You think, I'll take Panadol. It continues. You go to the hospital. You go for a scan. And they say it's actually bigger than ordinary headache. You think, I've got a small pain. You go to hospital or you take medication. It doesn't go. You go to hospital. It's bigger than you thought. Illness. Any other thing?
Jealousy.
Sorry?
Jealousy.
Jealousy. Jealousy. You think you are doing everything well. And people turn around and say, who is he? Where has he come from? I was present at his
at his naming ceremony last week. Jealousy. We went to school together. I was better than he was. Jealousy. Any other thing? Anita?
Anything that comes before the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit that takes the place of God.
Anything
that comes before God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, in his place.
Anything that we place before God can destabilize us. Money, career, job, sometimes family. They can destabilize us. Any other thing?
Moving from one place to another.
That's true. Moving from one place to another. Escaping from Greenford to Milton Keynes. Liz? Relationships can destabilize us. Accommodation. Bereavement. Yes, bereavement. If you are not happy with what God has given you, you're searching for greater things. You're looking for other things other than that God has given you. They can destabilize us. We let this event or things take hold and control of our lives instead of turning it instantly to God. As we passed to the lee of a small island called Kauda, we were hardly able to make the lifeboat secure. When the men had hoisted it aboard, they passed ropes under the ship itself to hold it together, fearing that they would run aground on the sandbars or Cytis. They lowered the sea anchor and let the ship be driven along. We took such a violent battering from the storm that the next day they began to throw the cargo overboard. So when things happen, we look for our own solutions. We think we've got solutions to everything. So this morning, you are here, Beechwood Avenue. You came in with issues, with problems, with situations. And you think, that thing, I'm going to defeat it. Yes, I am going to defeat it. This 3-bedroom is not good enough for me anymore. I need to find a 5-bedroom house in Milton Keynes that befits my status. It may be that's where you are this morning. These men haven't been battered by the storm. They became fearful. They start to wonder. They start to think, what can we do to save ourselves? They've tried everything. They've taken the lifeboat into the vessel. They put rope around the ship so as not to break up. And then they resorted to throwing things overboard, thinking that's going to solve the problem. Is that where you are? Is that what you are doing? Thinking you have the solution to the things going on in your lives. On the third day, They threw the ship's tackle overboard with their own hands. When neither sun nor stars appeared for many days and the storm continued raging, we finally gave up all hope of being saved. What a terrible situation to be in. What a terrible, terrible situation to be in. But I tell you this morning, there is hope. There is hope. There is hope because we have a God that is not a lying God. We have a God that is a powerful God. We have a God that can move those mountains in our lives. We have a God that changes to our situations and to our circumstances. We have a God, when he says, I will do this, he will do it. That is my God. That is your God. That is our God. We give up hope after we have relied on our own strength. Then we give up hope. Maybe you are at that stage when you declare, according to the Bible that says, you declare that the dead who already died are happier than the living who are still alive. You declare that the dead who have already died are happier than the living who are still alive. I have come this morning to declare and to say to you that my God, your God, is able and is abundantly able to intervene in those circumstances. You may think that your circumstance or circumstances are so dire, or that you are so desperate and there is no escape. But this morning, let God speak to you directly. Let him minister to you. Let him intervene on your behalf. The power and the authority that he exercised on behalf of the Israelite is still alive today. The Bible tells us in Isaiah chapter 41, verse 13, for I am the Lord, your God, who takes hold of your right hand and says to you, do not fear, I will help you. For I am your God, who takes hold of your right hand and says to you, do not fear, I will help you. So when those situations come, as they will come, sometimes in life, you need to hold on to the cross. You need to let God take control. You need to be looking at the cross and saying, God, I leave this at the throne. I surrender all. I surrender all to him, my blessed Savior. I surrender all. That's what we need to be saying. God, take control. Because it's not within my power. It's not within my authority. It's not something that I can deal with. It's not a problem that I can solve. But you can do it. The powers and the principalities, they caught Jesus. They took him before a kangaroo court. They nailed him to the cross. He died. They were happy. They thought they had finished their work. But God had other plans, just as he has other plans for you this morning. God had other plans. On the third day, he arose and he defeated death. He is able to do it. For he said, I am the Lord, your God, who take hold of your right hand and says to you, do not fear, I will help you. After my Milton Keynes misadventure, we said, well, God, everything is in your hand. And ashamed of myself, I came to members' meeting and said, well, it looks like God is saying that we will not be able to go to Milton Keynes anymore. We have to come before him with a humble heart. We need to be saying to him, God, it is not by my might, but by your amazing power that things are able to move in my life. God is here this morning and is present with you. Let's look at Psalm 139. Let's read from verse 8. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hands will guide me, your right hand will hold me fast. That provides some comfort, isn't it? It tells us that God is everywhere. And when you think those things, those situations, those circumstances are way above your strength, if you think that is it, I give in, I throw in the towel, God is there present with you. The language impossible is not in my God's dictionary. Because he makes the impossible what? Possible. The impossible is in human dictionary. It's in my dictionary, it's in your dictionary. But in God's dictionary, the word impossible is not there. It's not relevant. Because he makes everything. He created everything. The Bible tells me that he created the man. He created the sun. He created the earth. He created everything. And if my God creates all things, then who can be or what can be above him? And if nothing can stand before him, if nothing is up to him, then he has the power and the authority to move those mountains in my life. His power is still very much alive. and very potent. Let him move for you. Let him intervene on your behalf. Let people say, I thought, you know, when you pass them, they look back and say, I saw that man yesterday. It was miserable. And I want to go back to that psalm we first read, Psalm 95. Come, come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. To what? To the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is great God, the great King above all gods. In his hands is the earth and the mountain peaks belong to him. Are you going to allow that? When those situations come, sing, worship him, lift your hands up to him and say, God, I leave everything before you. I have put that before the throne. And I am singing in anticipation of the things that you are going to do in my life. I am singing, I am rejoicing because you are in control. It's not my problem, God. If you want, if you think that people will think you are crazy, you can do some acrobatic display in your bedroom. I have said it many times here, that sometimes we underestimate our own strength. You are children of the kingdom. You are children of the kingdom, and you need to walk like the children of the kingdom. You need to take control like the children of the kingdom. You need to move like the children of the kingdom. For so long, for too long, we allow situations, we allow circumstances to take hold of us. We allow those things in our lives to control and dominate our life. When you should actually be saying, yeah, I'm a child of God. He is in charge. You know? Sing and worship and praise him and thank him for the things that he's done in your life, that he's going to do. Because sometimes you can actually thank people, you can thank God in advance of the things that he's going to do. That shows the level of faith you have in your God. For I know that my Redeemer liveth. He's not dead. He is alive, he's here, he's present with me. Every time, everywhere I go, he is there walking with me. So why then do we think that situations and circumstances should overwhelm us? If today, I think what I've said, assume that you already know him. You already have a relationship with him. But if today you have no experience of him, I have good news for you. He is here present. He's just waiting patiently to say, Lord, I give it all for you. He can start to take hold of your situations. All you need is to confess him. Romans chapter 10, verse 9 says, that if you confess with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. And you can enjoy the privileges of the kingdom. You can walk like the child of the king. You can move like the child of the king. You can display like the child of the king. 1 John chapter 1 verse 9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. So it may be that this morning you thought, let me see what they do in that building. And you just wandered in and you come in. I'm telling you this morning, it's ready and it's prepared to meet with you, to intervene on your behalf. It's ready. Brothers and sisters, I'm saying this not because I've got all things in my life sorted. Nobody's got everything in their life sorted. But he is present here. And is able to do. The Bible says, even if your faith is as small as mustard seed, just imagine how small mustard seed is. It's not saying your faith level has to be as high as Mount Kilimanjaro or Everest. It's saying if it's as small as mustard seed. You're going to allow him? Are you going to allow him to take control and let him do what he has to do? All through history, God has demonstrated his power and his authority. God had met with people and moved things for them. When the brutality of the Egyptians was too much, the children of Israel, God heard them and he brought them out of Egypt. David, we have had a series of teachings on Exodus. If you have time, go and listen to them. How God moved for the children of Israel. How God made the impossible possible for them. How, as they left Egypt, they encountered the Red Sea. The Egyptian army was behind them. And they thought, that is it. It is finished. Kaput. But he parted the sea for them. And they walked through. We have seen people that God has done miraculous things for or through in the Bible. Esther, Daniel, even Joseph. And maybe this morning you are thinking, it is my time. Yes, it is your time for God to move in your situation.
don't know what Timmy had thought of doing at this point, but I feel that God would want people to have space to respond to what has been said this morning. I believe that God would say this morning, I hadn't realized as this came through my head, I turned to find it in Hebrews. What I hadn't realized is actually in the same psalm that Timmy was reading from, Psalm 95, which for me, in the way I understand God, he is speaking to us. He would say, this is what the Holy Spirit says today. When you hear my voice, don't harden your hearts. That's what he's saying to some of us, maybe all of us this morning. If you've heard my voice today, don't harden your hearts. And if you want to respond to God this morning, please come and speak with me afterwards for me to pray with you and for you. Thank you.
Thanks.
In the few minutes that remains, I don't know about you. I don't know what your thoughts are. All I want to say this morning is, let him take control. Let him move for you. Let him intervene on your behalf. Because our Lord is God. So after we've finished praying, which we'll do in a moment, and you want someone to just agree with you, you want to put anything before the cross, if you just come and take one of the seats here, Liz and other members of the leadership that are here will come with you and pray with you. Our God is no man that he should lie. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for your words that you have spoken to us, both to the hearer and the speaker. We thank you, Heavenly Father, because you have assured us and reassured us this morning that you are alive in our lives. And those burdens are small things. And that you are willing and you are able and abundantly able to do all things, only if we will let you take control. So Father God, Father in heaven, we want to pray by your Spirit that you be with us and your anointing will be upon us. That we will be the people that you want us to be. People that let your power move in our lives. And Father, as we go out this week, I pray that your Spirit, your anointing will go with your people. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that where there are problems, Father, you bring solutions. Where there are difficulties, Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray that you will intervene. I pray for each and every one of us that you meet us at our very point of need for your glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our phone number is 020 8575 5034 and our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.